All right, everyone. It's Monday. It is April 19th. Hi, everybody. I'm Joan Lunden. And I'm with you today on this Facebook Live for my PBS program, Second Opinion with Joan Lunden, which is going swimmingly on PBS. I'm happy to say it's gotten clearances in like almost all the PBS stations around the country. So I hope that you will go and check your local listings for shows on PBS in your hometown to see when it runs. Any problem in finding that, you can also watch all of our new episodes on our website. And that's secondopinion-tv.org. Again, secondopinion-tv.org. I'm so excited about who we have today as our guest. We have one of the preeminent experts on nutrition, Dr. T. Colin Campbell. If that name sounds familiar to you, it's because he wrote the China Study, which has just sold millions of copies worldwide. And he's also done other New York Times bestsellers, Whole, and the Low Carb Fraud. And he's got a new book out, which I'm very excited about, The Future of Nutrition. It's available right now in hard copy. And I have to tell you that I grew up, my dad really was, for the most part, plant-based, much to my mother's dismay. And she always tried to like infringe on that. But he used to just, he was a surgeon. Started out as a family practitioner, became a surgeon, then specialized in cancer. And he used to take my brother and me out, and on our property, he'd have us create gardens of all different kinds of vegetables, and he'd send it up in the little row, and he'd say, here are the plants, here are the seeds, and take us out there to water them, to let them grow. My mom said she could not figure out how to use all the zucchini that came out of that garden, but she found every way you could possibly cook it. So I was raised with kind of that sensibility, but unfortunately we then are kind of barraged with how the country and the food industry presents to us how we should eat. And so it's difficult, you know, it's confusing. And I'm so happy that so many of you are joining us today. Sherry Flowers Merklin from Connecticut. Bernadette, hi, good to have you back with us. And Ramon and Evangelista. Donna Lynn, I think you're South Jersey. Erie, Pennsylvania, we have Eileen Mayhew. I'm going to be going to Pennsylvania a lot starting in September. I officially accepted a faculty position there. I'm going to be a visiting professor teaching population health and the media. So I'm very excited about that. Beth, hi, Beth Malik from Naperville, Illinois. Ramona and Evangelista, you're here with us from the Philippines. I'm so happy you always join us. And it's your April 18th was your birthday? Well, happy birthday. I think I just saw Vincent, how you doing? How's everything going there in New York City? Are things getting back to normal a little bit? Neil Smith, you're joining us from the UK. Thank you so much. My family, my dad's side of the family came from the UK, but then Australia. He was born in Sydney, Australia. Goes back a few generations in Australia before you get back to the UK. Mary Jo, you're in Chicago. You're joining us. Cindy from New Jersey. Midge from Ohio. Did I get that right? Yes. And Bear Costa, Monica from New Hampshire, Julia from Georgia, Janet from Kansas, Michelle from Washington State, Pat from Stuart, Florida. I just came back from Florida. We were down there at our home. So happy to finally be double vaccinated and be willing to fly again. Atlanta, Georgia, Nina's with us. All right, so I'm going to keep going and I'll come back to you guys. Now, listen, during this Facebook Live today, I want you to listen and if you have questions, put your questions and I'll try to get to you. There have been several documentaries that have featured Dr. Campbell. If you didn't read the book China Study, you may have seen Forks Over Knives. I think I saw that on Netflix. loved it. My kids all loved it. Eating You Alive, Food Matters, Plant Pure Nation. He's also the founder of the T. Colin Campbell Center for Nutrition Studies and the online plant-based nutrition certificate in partnership with E. Cornell, which I'm very interested in that. So again, put in your questions if you have questions for Dr. Campbell. I am so excited to welcome Dr. Campbell to our Facebook Live. Hi, Dr. Campbell.
Hello. Thank you very much for having me. I'm looking forward to it.
I have been looking forward to this. So listen, it's been what, 20 years? I think since you wrote the China study?
Yeah, 2005.
And you wrote it with your son, Dr. Thomas Campbell, and he's from the University of Rochester Medical Center. I'm not sure if you know this, but we shoot our show at WXXI in Rochester, and we did one of our episodes on conquering obesity, and your son was a guest on that show, and he was terrific.
Well, believe it or not, I saw the link, so I watched it, actually. Very nice.
So he co-authored this with you. When you approached this, because you did a tremendous amount of research over a somewhat long period of time before, and that was the basis for the China study. Talk to us a little bit about your main findings and what made you so passionate about writing that particular book.
Well, you're right. I started a long time ago. Yeah. In graduate school doing research at that time on the same topic, and that was in 1956, believe it or not.
Whoa!
So I've been in this business for over 65 years, working on the same sort of idea, relationship of diet with health. But I think the thing I'd like to mention is that I started out coming from a farm and being trained in graduate school and doing my doctoral dissertation on promoting the consumption of more animal protein.
Wow.
That's where I was, all farm, this and that. I was believing basically everything that everyone else did. We had to have protein, you know, the best of protein is coming from animal foods, et cetera. But in any case, then I got into my research in 1965 as a faculty member. And I was at that time coordinating a program in the Philippines. On the campus, State Department program for feeding malnourished children. And there we were, as nutritional advisors, if you will, supposed to be helping them to consume more protein, high quality protein, animal-based protein, if you will. And that's what I took from the campus, from my personal background to that. But then I happened to see something that was kind of alarming. It seemed like the few children consuming more protein, like we do in the West, they had a higher risk of liver cancer. At least that's what I thought was true. Then there was a study in India, experimental animal study in that case, where they were showing that in liver cancer, if you increase animal protein consumption, you know, really elevates the cancer. So I had two things that were bothering me. You know, high animal protein causing cancer, that's kind of weird. It was hard to digest, no pun intended. But in any case, I came back home and organized a research, basic research program, NIH funded. That particular grant that I got lasted for 27 years. Later, I had another major grant working in China as well. But the sum and substance of all that work over the years was lots of students and colleagues and so forth and so on. Working in my lab, I learned that this idea of animal protein increasing cancer was true. It was true. And we did it in many different ways. And I had a chance to be a biochemist to go into the relationship and asking questions, well, if this is true, how does it work? You know, in a biochemical sense, we like to understand, you know, what exactly is changing. And that gives us confidence that the thing is true. I mean, I was kind of reluctant, you know, in the beginning, but as I started to look at things, I saw there's not one mechanism, there's a whole bunch of them all working together, and animal protein changes them all. They all converge, they kind of triangulate to an effect, in this case, increasing cancer, but then later also increasing the level of blood cholesterol in the blood, increasing this, increasing that. And first thing you know, I had to just look at the data the way they are. The animal protein was a problem. Plant protein didn't do that. Plant protein, you could have all you want, no problem. I mean, that's where our data were taking me at the time. And then I just mentioned one more thing, and we get on to some more questions. I had an opportunity to get quite deeply involved in national policy development, being on expert panels for the National Academy of Sciences, being on panels with the NIH, actually at one time being the representative of the medical community in Congress, as sort of the liaison with Congress. So I had a chance to see how policy is formed and, you know, how we get it wrong, quite frankly. Here I'm sort of seeing protein, animal protein being a problem. And yet, on the other hand, it's almost worshipped, been that way forever. And so for me to challenge that concept, that caused some difficulties from my colleagues and others. You know, why am I doing this here? I mean, this is a very highly revered nutrient and it's central to our diet and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So then I had that big experience over a period of about 40 years or so, having to contend with those who were opposed to this. That was a lesson.
Yeah.
That was a lesson. And I happened to be able to see in that process things going on, let's say, behind the curtain, you know, at the policy level, at the national level and so forth.
Politics. So
with my experience in the lab and then all that policy and lecturing, et cetera, I saw the whole journey, you know, from the basic sales, if you will, in the laboratory to what we tend to say with the public. It got me into quite involved with the media, I might add, that you're in media, because my face kind of got out there and I was talking about this. So I really learned too, I think a great deal about how the public sort of get educated, if you will. And there's a very interesting story behind, or history behind that. And that's the subject of my most recent book.
Yeah.
So I'll leave it at that. But
yeah, the future of nutrition. I mean, you really go through the history. And sometimes by learning the history of how we all began eating in the beginning, we ate actual real food that came out of the ground, and yeah, how farming started utilizing all these other things. And little by little by little, sugars began to be added. And, you know, we got to where we are now, which is that a whole lot of the food that we eat, it's just not the natural food that comes out of the ground. And I've talked on this program before about the book called The Blue Zones, which are those areas in the world where people live exponentially longer. Well, one of those happens to be in the United States. It's Loma Linda, California. And why? Because the predominant population in Loma Linda, California are Seventh-day Adventists who are vegetarians. My dad was a Seventh-day Adventist. He graduated from Loma Linda University. So that's why he was a cancer surgeon. So he was a huge proponent in, you know, a plant-based diet. But, and we do hear these things. I mean, you hear like, okay, those people live longer. I hear it even from my primary care physician who changed to a plant-based diet. And we had talked about some aches and pains. And she said, when I did that, all my aches and pains went away. So talk to us a little bit about what areas of our health can a plant-based diet make a significant improvement in terms of obesity, diabetes, heart disease, blood pressure?
All of the above and far more. In other words, this is really, I focused initially on cancer, you know, and how nutrition relates to cancer, if you will. But that also offered me a chance to actually looking at mechanisms again and that sort of thing, to come to the realization that this diet, whole food, plant-based, no animal protein, if you will, that kind of diet operates by a ton of different kinds of so-called mechanisms. Lots of nutrients are involved. They all work together. It's fascinating, this concept of holism, I call it. They all work together in our body to create a whole array, a very broad array of outcomes, which we call diseases or prevent them, if you will, if you're consuming plants. So the story became more than just about animal protein causing cancer. It had to do with, you know, it related to a lot of these diseases. In fact, it got to a point, I finally got to a point realizing, you know, the magnanimity, I guess you could say, of this whole story. I came to sort of say to myself, hey, I'm looking at nature. This is what nature does. This is the way it works. And she's had, you know, a few million years to sort of arrange for the way our cells work. And what's so marvelous about this, Joan, is the fact that there are so many reactions going on, you know, in the hundreds of thousands and millions of reactions all working together. And they all work in together, you know, like notes in a symphony.
Yeah.
Or, you know, the brush strokes in a great piece of art, if you will. So, and that's the part that I really got excited about.
So we do have people, you always get asked this question, I know, and we have people asking, but does plant protein build red blood cells in children the way red meat does? We were told in an early childhood nutrition class that you need red meat to build red blood cells in children. What is your take on that, Dr. Campbell?
Well, that's not true. I mean, red meat, yes, can help, I suppose, in a way, but it has downsides. Actually, plants provide all the protein we need. That's one of the major findings that we don't need any protein from animal foods. And that became early on the sort of the justification for advocating animal food consumption to make sure we get enough protein, if you will. It turns out with that thought in mind, and we have all thought that for decades and decades and decades, we ate the animal food, justified our eating these animal products that I grew up on. But in reality, you just supposed to get the protein. But the animal protein is actually what's been shown very clearly to increase blood cholesterol levels and creating, you know, blood cells, let's say, in youngsters. Specifically on that, I hadn't heard that claim being made before, but there's a lot of claims that sort of came out.
Yeah.
Need protein to do this, that, or something else. That's really not true.
And of course we know we have a never before seen epidemic of obesity among children. I mean, more than 2/3 of American adults are overweight. 1/3 are obese. And I've been told that they are seeing type 2 diabetes in youngsters 11 and 12 years old. And we've never seen this happen before in our history.
Right. That is coupled too, especially the type 2 diabetes that you're mentioning. That's also coupled with something else we do is not exactly right. We use a lot of I call them convenience foods. Those foods that, you know, they're packed with sugar and fat and salt. Those particular flavors, I mean, that kind of thing, they're addictive. They sell products. And so, you know, you go into little stores along the highway and stuff like that, where they have a whole array of those so-called foods. They're kind of tasty because we're used to that taste. And the more we consume them, the more we like them. So that combination, you know, using, that's why I like to say whole foods. Taking it all apart, pulling out the salt and sugar and fat and putting it in something else to sell a product, that's not a very good idea. Even if they say, well, you've got good protein there, I mean, they'll make their health claims in a way in which, you know, a little bit of truth there.
Yeah.
Just completely ruins the whole, it sells products is really what it does.
So, I mean, the evidence for everybody listening is pretty compelling that if you move to a plant-based diet and of whole foods, that this is going to protect you from a lot of cancers and heart disease and type 2 diabetes. But Dr. Campbell, how do you encourage, I think this is really that kind of the conundrum, how do you encourage people to adopt, to move over to a plant-based diet when a lot of people feel that that's more expensive because, you know, we do have these what do they call them? Nutrition deserts around our country, where it costs so much money to buy fresh fruits and vegetables, or that it takes longer to plan and prepare meals. I mean, nobody likes change. Like, well, let's just all admit that. But we want to give you the compelling evidence today to really embrace the idea that at least partially starting to make this changeover will be good for you short term and long term. But what are the big roadblocks here?
Well, first off, the information we get, through the media, through recommendations coming from government and stuff like this, it really favors the status quo. And they're not likely to talk about this, what I'm talking about, because it really does undercuts, the products that are being sold, quite frankly.
Yeah.
It's a big contest.
Food industry, big industry.
The food industry, the drug industry, et cetera. There's a one thought, and I'm not speaking as a clinician in this case, but I've just heard enough about it and experienced it ourselves too. One thing that people should know, number one, I guess if it's possible, if they can become convinced that the scientific data supporting this is superior, is absolutely outstanding.
Yeah.
Okay, now let's say I'd like to get there, but I don't know whether I can do that kind of thing. Yeah. Then the second thought comes into play, namely, if they stay with it, really stick to it, or let's say a month, two, maybe 2 months or so, their taste preferences change. And first thing you know, they're craving a salad. And they look back and then they don't go back. Once they get over that hump, for a lot of folks, that's a pretty big, big in the beginning to get there. But once they get there, the food tastes delicious. I mean, I'm speaking through personal experience, and my wife and I and our children and the whole family, et cetera, that we got there and now we couldn't eat anything different. So just that recognition that it will work, stay with it kind of thing, I think is it.
Well, I mean, by the way, you guys, anybody who gets the China study or this new book, The Future of Nutrition, and in The Future of Nutrition, you will learn about all the politics, all the policy, everything that goes on behind the scenes to make a whole lot of people a whole lot of money and to addict you to all the foods with all the sugar and the salt and everything in it, but how bad some of all that processing is for you and the stripping away from nutrients before the bread actually gets into your house. I think that if you read that, you'll do yourself the biggest favor in the world, and it'll also help you because you'll start to understand the real science behind it. I want to ask though, Anna Bernardini, she's saying, so you're also saying no eggs and no fish.
I mean, that's the ideal. That's the goal. I don't like to be really hard-nosed, but really quite frankly, anything, but that's the ideal. No eggs, no fish. Now, we know that some folks can smoke until they're 95, and probably get right few individuals. But it's a good idea to learn not to use those things, if you will. We have some specific data that, in some cases, both of those kinds of foods, they do have some downsides. And
dairy also.
Of course, those three, dairy, fish, and eggs, if you will, they're one of the main sources of the protein that I'm talking about, the animal protein. And the more animal protein we consume in the form of whatever kind of animal food we're using, the more animal protein we consume, because calorie intake is a zero-sum game, the more of that we make up as animal food, we consume less plant food. That's a big cost right there. That's a big burden. Because we decrease plant food, got the good stuff. So, if you really want the best, go the whole way.
So, and I was told by one nutritionist, I remember, said, we're the only animal on earth that drinks the milk of another animal. That, you don't see that anywhere else. We're the only ones that drink the milk of another species.
Absolutely. I became familiar with that idea straight off early in my career because here I grew up milking cows.
Oh, of course.
So, you know.
Oh, you made a left turn. I mean, it took years. It was a long, like an ocean liner turning, but still, it was a big turn. So now we have a couple of comments. First of all, maybe we can put up, guys, behind the scenes here, the name of the book, because somebody says, again, what's the name of the book? The Future of Nutrition. So I want to take a couple questions, doctor. One of them is, what are the best veggies in high protein? Because a lot of people are afraid if they're going to take the meat out, like where do they look for the protein? So she's asking, what are the best veggies high in protein?
Well, the first one that usually we mention is legumes, beans and peas and that sort of thing. I mean, they're good sources.
So what, then tell us what is all for anybody who, what are all the different kinds of legumes?
Well, as I say, peas and beans and lentils, you know, any of those kind of foods are really good sources of protein. But, you know, we don't need to really even concern ourselves all that much, because our requirement for protein is lower than a lot of people than we've been led to believe. And so if you're just eating whole foods, we can get protein easily, the 10% that's more or less recommended. We can get up to 10, 15, 20% even by loading up leafy green vegetables too, in terms of percent of total calories in those foods. So legumes, leafy greens, okay. Nuts and seeds too are protein as well.
And that's how you can get your crunchiness, because some people are sweet people and some people are the crunchy, salty people. I'm the crunchy, salty kind, but I have really found that I was a Tostito fanatic, and I now am a pistachio nut, and in the evening, maybe some cashew nuts. And I do a lot of nuts. And when I make a salad, I put all these sunflower and the pistachio and the different kinds of nuts. And that gives me, and I cut up celery, dice it up, and that gives me that crunchiness that I crave. And I've become, now I really love that.
Right. Yeah, and my wife does the same thing. By the way, if they hadn't gotten there.
All right, there you go. So now you can see the cover of the book, The Future of Nutrition. What's the tell them the byline, because I like the byline.
The byline says, an insider's look at the science, why we keep getting it wrong, and how to start getting it right. Pretty audacious and bold, I guess, but.
No, I don't think so. So another person is saying, so talk to me about proper nutrition for someone with diabetes. And I have a son who has type 1 diabetes, and he's not good at eating vegetables and really not good at eating fruits. And but he's 18, almost 18. So it's really been difficult for me to get him, to show him the right way.
I don't know the answer to that, to be honest about it. I haven't been a coach of,
diabetics,
especially with type 1 diabetes.
Yeah.
That starts out early on, as you know. One of the things we do know with type 1 diabetics, oh, by the way, is that they're on their medication, of course, on a continual basis.
Right.
And it's also for type 2, they're sort of similar in that sense, but if we all of a sudden introduce a whole food plant-based diet on top of the medication, the whole food plant-based diet actually depresses blood sugar levels, just like the medication does. In fact, if you do the two together, the blood sugar levels at times can go too low. Anyhow, that's not relevant to the question that you're just asking, I think.
Yeah.
But still, the diet works. I don't know what else to say.
I mean, we can see that the people living on those diets live enough of a longer life to really differentiate them right from the rest of us. I have a couple more people. Here's Linda Warren Cawthorn said, I just purchased the book on Amazon. Sylvia says, I've been eating more sardines to ease joint inflammation. What kind of plant foods could ease inflammation?
Could ease inflammation. It's a whole nine yards in a sense.
Yeah, it's a lot of them.
It's a lot of stuff, and it's all working together. And they have plants tend to have what we call omega-3 fats, which are anti-inflammatory.
Yeah.
And we're accustomed, unfortunately, in a typical American diet, consuming too many of the omega-6 fats, which are pro-inflammatory. And it's the ratio of the two that we got to kind of manage. That's the metric that we need to be concerned about. But in any case, plants, they have a lot more omega-3 and less omega-6.
And the threes are the ones that we all want.
That's right, exactly. The threes are ones
which I love because that includes avocados.
Yes. That's right. Plants have the threes and a good generous amount of them. We do too much of the sixes and we get a pro-inflammatory diet. Not good.
Somebody else is asking, what about all the problems that are being seen with wheat? This is going to go back to that farm conversation, doctor.
Yes. Well, to some extent, that has been exaggerated for the general population. It's clear, though, on the one hand, I don't want to be too audacious about my comment here, but it's clear that chronic Crohn's disease, for example, irritable bowel syndrome, those kind of things, they're real. They're real. We got to face it. So some people who discover that they have that problem, and if they eliminate wheat, okay, eliminate wheat. Just to go with the flow and stay away from that kind of thing. There was a big deal made about one of the authors, I don't think I'll mention his name, who really went out to say, oh, it's not just for the chronic obstructive lung disease people. At least 40% of us or 50% of us are that way. He was trying to sell a book. Yeah. About it. But I do want to acknowledge the fact that wheat can be a problem, as some other foods can too. They have allergenic responses. We just need to identify for ourselves what are they and stay away from them. But yeah, generally, wheat is a good product.
And you can get tested to find out if you're sensitive to it. Because if you're not sensitive to it, then you don't have to be all crazy about it. I mean, I got tested, and ironically, I was tested to be have a sensitivity to gluten, which I didn't even know. But I just went and found I did testing one day. But, you know, we spend, I don't even know what the amount is, $200-300 billion a year or something on diet and weight loss. And yet it seems like we just keep getting it wrong. We take out one food or something. Let me ask you, what do you think about the paleo diet? And for anybody who doesn't know, paleo diet is kind of based on how the people ate in the Paleolithic era, I don't know, 20,000 years ago, whatever it is, where they hunt and gathered. So it's very much plant-based, but it still has some meat in it.
Yeah, actually, there's sort of two answers to that. I know the fellow who actually originated that idea, Professor Colorado State University. I've debated him twice on the air, once on Larry King Live and another one in Wall Street Journal. But I know the story, how he got started in it. He was an exercise fellow, exercise science, fine fellow, by the way. But we have difference of opinion. He agrees that we shouldn't use dairy. That was the original paleo message.
Yeah.
Fortunately, the paleo diet took on a broader sort of a meaning in a sense for a lot of people in the public. And for a lot of people, they thought that meant loading up on animal foods. So it became the paleo diet. People who do that are typical Atkins type people. They want to make sure they get enough protein. That's not exactly what was intentionally meant when that came out. So the paleo diet has a popular impression. Yeah, they avoid dairy and they're more vegetarian, as you might add. But in reality, the way the public bought into it was just another way of making sure that they got lots and lots of keto, the keto thing.
Yeah,
and that kind of thing. So, I don't go for that. The Paleolithic argument was an interesting one, of course. It's like to learn where did we come from and what were we doing at that time? But we didn't test it that way.
Yeah, the whole idea being that when we first came to this earth and started eating what was available, which remember are plants,
right,
and fruits and wheats and grains and nuts and seeds. And then if they caught something, you'll bring animal fat into it, but none of the processed stuff, none of the sugar stuff. And that then farming, as I understand it, and I know you come from the farm, but that when farming started changing things, that what we get today in a package of bread or in a pasta here in this country is a far cry from what it was originally, and that our system, our stomach and our digestive system was never really made to deal with that. Thus, we have all these, you know, a plethora of digestive issues.
Yeah, the agriculture movement, according to classical studies, sort of started like 10,000 BC, cultivating land and that sort of thing, and having animals for eating to some extent for those who afford it. But then there was another sort of evolution, almost revolution, that has occurred during our lifetime. That is, in my day when I was growing up, we were family farms, small. You know, a lot of family farms, that's where the way they were. But then it started to change. We started becoming industrialized. And I, as I say, I can see this, and I know some of the folks who were advising on this straight on in the 1960s. Factory farms eventually emerged. Yeah. It was all a sort of a business initiative, you know, increasing numbers of units or numbers of animals to produce a given amount of food, because the margin of profit is kind of narrow. Farmland started to be, especially in Eastern, taxed more. So it made it difficult for the small farmer. They couldn't compete. And so now, I don't know what the latest number is, so maybe 60% or there's really a very high amount of the farm produce that is now produced on factory farms. I don't like factory farms.
Yeah, yeah.
They
for good reason.
Yeah, they've created a lot of...
Killing us.
Well, they did it because, you know, they assumed, and rightfully so in a sense, this is what the public wanted to have. They wanted the meat, they wanted the dairy, let's face it, or chickens and so forth. So they're playing to the market. They couldn't care less, as far as I'm concerned, about the health. And so we're all sort of to blame for this kind of thing in a sense.
But America spends more money on healthcare than per capita than any other country in the world. And consequently, you would think that we would be the healthiest. And it's just the fact that 2/3 of the population, you know, are overweight, that 25 million Americans are diabetic. And I think the figure is something like, you know, 79 million Americans are pre-diabetic and 90% of them are unaware of it. So they don't realize that they're right up against that very dangerous mark where if they keep eating the way they're eating, they're going to all of a sudden find themselves with type 2 diabetes. And that's a tremendous hit to your lifestyle. It's a horrible, horrible change to your lifestyle.
It sure is. And there's some others that we don't hear a lot about, but chronic kidney disease is another one. It involves some 30 to 40 million people. Very serious. That's a very costly one. But, you know, one of my favorite expressions in talking about the question you just raised is, we don't know what we don't know. And so we're kind of oblivious, you know, to our sort of wayward ways of doing things. And we just sort of automatically assume that what we're doing is okay. Unless, you know, and somebody comes along and challenges that's a problem. We don't accommodate that too well. So, the diabetes thing has kind of crept up on us and these kind of diseases, you know, all coming from more or less the same dietary problem, eating too much of the animal-based foods. Not enough of plant-based foods, and not making them whole plant-based foods.
But, you know, I think that, you know, it's not that we don't know. It's that we put blinders on because it's so hard. It's so much easier. Like somebody just said here, Charles de Matas. Yeah, I get out of breath if I try to read all the ingredients on a bag of bread. You know, but it's hard sometimes to try to move to more quality organic products. You know, little by little, I think people are starting to, just like when the exercise revolution came along, it took decades for everybody to embrace the idea that we actually need the amount of exercise. That doesn't mean they're all doing it, but at least they know that they need it. And I think now we're on that same kind of curve, hopefully. But I think a lot of it has to be that maybe we're preaching to the wrong choir. We have to preach to the public, but we also have to preach to our politicians and to the doctors, to the actual medical doctors, the medical community. Because for a long time, and it may have changed now, when you went through medical school, you never took a course on nutrition.
Well, that's true even today. You know, there's not a medical school in the United States, not one, that really teaches nutrition.
That's crazy.
Yeah, about one fourth of them, the latest figures I've seen, will teach, they claim, the very minimum number of hours, but it's the wrong kind of nutrition. So I have to say, the whole medical profession, unfortunately, are totally oblivious to this kind of information.
So to me, that's like one of the first nuts that has to be cracked.
Yes, it does. It really absolutely does. And they, well, I say what you really said it. They also, there's another thing, physicians, by the way, don't get paid, don't get reimbursed for services by working in this area using nutrition. They get paid according to the CPT code or the ICD code. You know, they target, they say, okay, I worked with this patient, here's what I diagnosed, here's what I did for them, you know, that kind of thing. So that goes into the form of reimbursement. This supports reimbursement. Do you know there's 130 different medical specialties they can check off, and more, quite frankly. There's not one called nutrition.
That's crazy. Okay, so here's Stephanie. Here's Stephanie Juhas Bill. This might not be an answerable question, but what will it take for U.S. health policy to become consistent with what we know to be true about whole foods, plant-based eating? It's baffling that we can ignore nutrition as an important part of health and healthcare. That, you know, that's really, I guess this is the, whatever they call it, the $60,000 question, is how do you start to, I mean, what comes first, to the chicken or the egg? Sorry, I use chicken as a, and an egg as my thing, but do you try to get this over to the public so that they then try to go to their politicians to get things changed? Or is it more important to try to attack the politicians and the health policy makers? Because of course you're going to be coming up against hugely financed lobbies of, you know, the meat and the dairy and all of those kind of lobbies. It just seems like such a huge hurdle to get over. And yet they're such obvious. I mean, somebody asked, is it really true that you'll live longer if you eat a plant-based diet? Yeah. And that's been proven.
That your father,
men right here that helped prove it.
That's right. The Seventh-day Adventists led the way on that one.
Yeah.
That's really good data. We do live longer. No question about it.
Yeah.
Probably we even could go longer than those data first indicated, because not all of them were doing exactly the right thing. But in any case, coming back to the government, what can we do? I think a lot about that because I was involved in that sort of thing. There's two agencies in the government that are participating in this, shall we call it, charade?
Yeah.
We got the ag industry that's looking after farmers. They use subsidies and so forth and so on to support, unfortunately, the kind of production, the kind of food that makes us sick. That is the Department of Agriculture. They develop dietary guidelines. I know it like the back of my hand. That's what their job is. That's controlled politically, because the Secretary of Agriculture has a final say on what the guidelines are going to say, and that's a political appointee, depending on the administration, you know, at that time. The second agency in the government, too, is the health industry, in the form of Health and Human Services, gigantic industry, spend lots of money. And in that particular industry, they harbor or host, if you will, the National Institutes of Health. That's where Sun supported at least 90% of my research through the years. They actually are in favor of the drug industry. They're very deeply influenced by the drug industry. So on one hand, you got one organization that's producing, supporting the production of the wrong food to make us sick.
Yep.
It creates more customers for the second part of the equation. Oh, well, you know, that I'm not sure. I'm not saying people sit around and talk that way, but you get more sickness. Now you have to make them well. Then we have the drugs. So nutrition is left out of the equation in both cases.
So we have more people coming on and joining. And want to just hold up the book one more time. New book, and you're listening to Dr. T. Colin Campbell, who wrote The China Study, just like the Bible of good eating. But the new book is called The Future of Nutrition, and I find it very interesting. And a couple of questions about this. I mean, somebody says when you talk about diet, obviously you have to add exercise. Yes, Joseph, that's absolutely true. But someone says, is there a long-term effect if you eat organic versus non-organic vegetables and fruits? How important is that?
Yeah, I'm glad that question was asked. We tend to think, and too many people believe, that if they're going to have to consume plant-based foods, you know, they have to have the organic. That's a bigger cost, as most cases. It's a little more expensive food.
Yeah, that's where it's expensive.
Choosing organic food is okay. We don't have really good data to prove that point, by the way. We do in our family. It just makes sort of common sense. But, you know, if you can afford it, but it is a little more expensive. What people need to know, they don't have to have that. The biggest decision they need to make is, let's just get some vegetables and fruits and grains.
So somebody said, yeah, but the other way was sold to us. It was pitched to us by the industrial food industry. Somebody asked, so like, what would be typical meals a day for you?
Whatever my wife fixes. I say that, but it's really true. She's really gotten into this from the very beginning, raised our children and paid a lot of attention to that. She gradually changed the recipes she was using. And we have a daughter who wrote the China Study cookbook and a daughter-in-law who's written one really very successful one called Plant Pure Nation cookbook. That's Kim Campbell.
We're gonna put these, everybody listening with Second Opinion, let's make sure to put these other books up, because as people listen to us right now, they're going to say, look, all this research was done. Obviously the science is there, but how do I do this?
Right.
And to me, the answer has been getting great cookbooks that teach me how to make delicious meals that are plant-based, because that's the only way I can kind of, you know, change my family over.
Absolutely. I often said that all of those of us who are in this business of sort of sharing information with the public, I think the key people are the chefs, you know, are really making the food.
Oh, yeah.
It really is really important.
And Pamela Voorhees, you're saying no meat. I just heard no meat. Yeah, no meat. And that really kind of includes, I mean, the biggest issue, of course, is red meat. But then there's also the chicken and fish Dr. Campbell really takes that out, and dairy as well. But as I think he said in the beginning, he doesn't want to be hard-nosed with you guys, because he just wants you to start eliminating some of these things. But packaged foods and processed foods that are filled with sugar and salt and chemicals that we weren't ever meant to eat. And same with cookies and snack products. They're just filled with all this stuff. And I dare you to try to even pronounce the names of those things on the side of the package. So here's somebody who might have just come on. So help me understand how I'm going to get my protein on a plant-based diet.
Well, they don't need it. They can forget the question. Just eat a plant-based diet. They'll get all the protein they need. Just have variety, some leafy vegetables, grains, legumes, of course, fruits. We'll get all the protein we need. And more importantly, we'll get the right kind of protein. So we can just, that was a myth to say that we had to eat animal food in order to get the protein. I write about that. I'm doing that right now. Couple of key papers for significant journals.
I'm going to ask you a question that, I mean, there's no like real clear cut answer for, but how do you see the future? I mean, the science is here and everybody who like reads it is, I mean, it's hard to refute that if you eat a plant-based diet, you're going to have less cancer, less diabetes, less heart disease, and you're going to live longer. But at how do you see the future of plant-based eating in healthcare? Like, when will doctors finally wise up and start, instead of letting people get sick and then having to prescribe medications to deal with the sickness, how do you see the medical profession, like my personal physician actually like read all these books and changed over and can't even believe. And I should just say, I myself, I started like in the morning, instead of doing my eggs or my whatever it is, my bacon, egg and cheese, I started doing a smoothie in the morning, and I put in spinach and kale. I put in cucumbers. I'm allowed to put in avocado to get that good omega-3. I put in some fruits, usually a lot of watermelon because they're really all water. Maybe some berries, but I can also use mango or papaya, different things, just not too much fruit. I usually put in a little protein powder. What am I forgetting in there? A little ice. And I mean, it's a green smoothie, but I'm here to tell you that it tastes good. But when I went on this and I started eating my other two meals as more plant-based, I had this chronic pain in my hip. I went for acupuncture. I went for physical therapy. I went for that thing where they roll. It's like torture. I went for electric stimulation on the acupuncture. Nothing helped. And I went on this plant-based and this great green smoothie in the morning with the omega-3s. And I'm here to tell you that within 4 or 5 days, all of my pain went away. I thought it was maybe an injury that I suffered from. It was obviously inflammation inside my body. And as long as I stay on, you know, primarily this kind of eating plan, if I go back, the pain in my hip comes back. So it's pretty well evidenced. I mean, I know where it comes from now because I have it, my own self-evidence in my body. But I was amazed that I was doing it for weight loss and I was doing it to my digestive system. You know, I had chemo and B got older and your digestive system slows down. But I also had a lot of issues with my pancreas from all that aggressive chemo. And by going on this kind of a diet, it really fixed my digestive system. But the thing I wasn't expecting is that it took away the pain in my joint.
That's amazing. I've heard those stories before, by the way.
Yeah.
They really work. You touched on something that should be mentioned here, by the way. We tend to think of the whole food plant-based diet or vegetables in general. We heard this from our grandmothers. You know, it could prevent certain diseases from occurring in the future. We tend to dismiss those ideas. We don't get too excited about that prevention idea. But in any case, what we're now knowing, this same diet actually can be used to reverse and to treat these diseases. Like you said, the pain went away. We know in the case of heart disease, it's brilliant. It's fantastic. My colleagues, Dr. Caldwell Esselstyn, Dr. Ornish, Dr. McDougall, you know, some of these folks and now lots more, are actually all doctors, clinicians. They just switch over like this, and you can see the effects occurring within almost 24 hours. It's amazing.
Yeah, I mean, I noticed it so quickly, I couldn't even believe it.
I think that's the future. You're asking about the future. I think one of the main things about the future is to realize if they change, they can actually correct the problems they now have, and then get on with going to. Going down and taking a different journey.
So, doctor, I'm getting the text that says, I know you're loving this, but we've been going for longer than planned. We can ask Dr. Campbell to go in and answer some of the people's questions, and you can always have him back. They knew I was going to go over in time because I couldn't wait to talk to you. It's really, to me, it's a subject that's so incredibly important when you think of the health of the population, of whether it's the United States or the world, all the different populations in the world. Everybody talks about heart disease. Everybody talks about, you know, diabetes. Everybody talks about a pandemic. And when the most basic thing, just what we choose to put into our mouth and eat on a daily basis, is really the biggest and most deadly epidemic of all.
Yeah. Can I mention one more thing
Sure. Real
quickly? Of the biggest problems we now face, not talked about enough yet, is the environment. The food that we now eat is responsible for the environmental problems. It is a major cause of environmental problems we now have. I've worked with the World Bank on this. I've worked with the United Nations. I've given lectures before both of those groups. Some of the folks who are aware of the data, looking at the data, it's really, really serious. If we don't start changing our food, and therefore cut down on deforestation, cut down on, you know, the soil loss that we now experience, and cut down on the underground water, you know, that gets in our water supplies. Agriculture now produced the way it is, so that we can eat the wrong food. It's a whole panoply. You know, we got to change our diets and then correct the environmental problem in the process, or we won't be around, so to speak.
Yeah.
But anything.
This is a major important subject for every one of us, for all of us as parents, so that we bring up our, I mean, I co-authored a book about 10 years ago called Growing Up Healthy. And it was all about the habits that we instill in our children, not only the foods we serve them, but the habits we instill in them, how that can either set them up for chronic illness the rest of their lives, or, you know, predispose them or protect them from chronic illness. So as parents, it's our goal, it should be our duty to try to introduce more of the plant-based foods in our home and to teach our children to not grow up always wanting that burnt bacon, that crispy bacon. Doctor, thank you, thank you, thank you. I will invite you back again. And I want to invite you to speak at the, as I'm becoming a professor at Lehigh University teaching population health in the media, I hope you'll join me there as well.
Well, congratulations on that, being in academia.
My Thank
favorite
you.
Place, yes.
Thank you. All right, Dr. Campbell, so great to have him join us. And for all of you who've been with us today, thanks all of you for being here. And by the way, if you're joining us today on my Facebook page, go head on over to Second Opinions Facebook page and join there as well, because we're always posting new health information for you over there. And if you're joining from that page, hey, come on over to my page. I'd love to have you here as well. And catch up on any episodes of my PBS program, Second Opinion with Joan Lunden. You can find those episodes also at secondopinion-tv.org. So from all of us at Second Opinion, we encourage you, be knowledgeable and take charge of your health and your health care. Be well, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you.